Well, everyone, thank you for coming. I'd like to introduce Glenn Campbell, who is the author of a book in progress called The Case Against Marriage. My students in advanced study in intimate relationships this semester had to read that book in progress and to respond to it, or any portions thereof, and apparently some students were emailing Mr. Campbell, and this just kind of evolved to having him come down and talk about marriage. So without further ado, I welcome Mr. Campbell.
You might get a hint about what I'm going to be talking about, but really I want to talk about the meaning of life, I want to talk about the nature of truth, I want to talk about free will, and just all sorts of interesting stuff that I think are going to tie into marriage and what marriage is. I think we really, before we start, I don't expect to win this debate. I'm just going to give it the old college try. And I hope that I will change your, at least change your view of what the institution is and break this whole thing up. You know, we think of marriage as a package. Let's try to break it up into its component parts and see which of those component parts we need, which we don't need, what's going to help us, what's really going to hurt us. I think the most important thing we all recognize is the relationship itself. I think that how well you get along with this other person on a day-to-day basis is really what's important. It's not what people think you are. It's not the commitments you've made publicly. It's how you get along on a day-to-day basis. My question is, by entering into the institution of marriage, are you helping your relationship, or are you hurting your relationship? You know, it's not a simple case of boy meets girl. Well, imagine, think of how Hollywood looks at love. Boy meets girl, they have some conflicts, there's something they've got to work out, they work it out, they fall into each other's arms, and they get married. Okay, we all recognize it's not that simple, and the real question is, after that happy ending, what happens next? What happens after you get married? And I think so, that's what we want to talk about today. Before I try to burst anybody's bubbles, I think we ought to start with a simple definition. Can we figure out what marriage is? And I'd like you to tell me what it is. I mean, before I can shoot something down or try to address something, we need to agree on what we're talking about. So can somebody tell me what marriage is? Somebody. Helena.
Oh, my gosh. Marriage...
Maybe there's a list of things we can say. What? First, let's start with Webster's definition. What is marriage? What would Webster say marriage is?
The uniting of two people by a public contract.
Okay, can we boil that down? It's a public contract.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, it's a public contract that says what?
That says you are committed to each other.
Okay, it's telling
you. Financially and emotionally.
Okay. Let's call it a public announcement. It's an announcement to the world that we are committed to each other for life, that we're a couple, that we should be associated together. Okay. What else? What else can marriage be? What under the law? What is it?
Sharing assets and
okay. Go ahead.
Oh, that's just one.
Sharing assets. Well. In addition, instead of calling it a public contract, we want to call it a public announcement. It's a public announcement of our love for each other. it's a way of saying, okay, we're a couple. It means I'm not looking for anyone else right now. In fact, it's usually saying, I'm committed to this person forever. You're getting up in front of your family and friends, and you're saying, we are committed to each other forever. But as she pointed out, it's also a legal contract. That means there's certain obligations, benefits, legal benefits, and obligations to what marriage is. Yes?
Yeah, I think the question, what is marriage, is difficult to answer. Obviously, nobody's really jumping in there. I think we have to address two questions here. What is marriage, and what is marriage supposed to be? I think the answer to both of those questions are different.
Okay, give me one answer.
In terms of dimensions, marriage is a legal contract, but marriage also is a spiritual contract.
Okay.
Okay, so we're going into different dimensions here. There's a fork in the road.
I'm not a spiritual person, so can you tell me a little bit more what a spiritual contract is?
Well, it's defined by religious institutions.
Okay.
I believe religion is a universal institution,
uh-huh.
regardless of what the particular religion is, has some definition, some accountability or responsibilities associated with marriage.
Mm-hmm. So in relationship to God.
There is a religious definition of marriage, either okay. being a sacrament or being a commitment of a high level between two people where both assume responsibilities towards each other in a way that they are not accountable to anyone else.
Okay.
I'm going to have to disagree with that because people who aren't spiritual get married.
And I have to disagree with you because everybody spiritual in your view would say that.
When I'm asking for a list of things that marriage is, you could get married for any of these.
Sure.
You could get married for
I'd like to add one more dimension to this. It's not only what marriage is or what marriage was or should be. Okay, we have to put what marriage was as well. I mean, all three of those. What marriage is, what marriage was, and what marriage is should be.
I'm more thinking of when you get married today in this day and age, what are you expecting out of it? What do you want marriage to be for you?
Marriage is a personal contract with the other person
okay.
to share your life, to share your experiences, to share just a lifetime together.
Is it? Yes. Ms. Mayo.
I've also heard people getting married like in the army or something because there's something where you can get one for it.
Yeah, so this is a lot like this one. You know, we can really say for financial, for personal gain, for concrete financial or practical gain.
Mm-hmm.
And you know, and if you have in traditional marriage, ancient marriages, where marriages were arranged, of course these are very much, let's call this a business contract, a business arrangement. In fact, in the ancient days, when one family, one well-to-do family married another, it wasn't really about love or anything like that. It was all about what can we join, do, what's the business transaction we can cement with this marriage arrangement. Yes, ma'am?
Having a family and kids.
Okay, we call that a parenting contract. And I understand that. That's one reason we could get married. You may want to, you feel that you need some sort of base before you have children. Is there anyone else that have some ideas of what marriage is? Yes, sir.
I would say the social and spiritual contract between one man and one woman.
Okay, and we have a spiritual contract. The public announcement is something sort of a social contract in a way. Legal contract. contract concerns the law. We can kind of put down here a social contract. This is just kind of a thumbnail so we have something to talk about. We're not trying to be very scientific here. But this, you know, we've got 7 points. Let's start with those and see what we can talk about there. For the past 3 years, I've spent a lot of time as an observer of family court in Las Vegas. And family court is the place where divorces happen. Several other things happen there. Child custody, child abuse cases happen there, and juvenile justice cases happen there, and divorces happen there. So for the past 3 years, I've had the occasion of studying marriage from the other end. You know, the Hollywood and novels are full of the front end part of marriage, you know, falling in love, getting married, living happily ever after. I've had the great privilege of watching things at the other end, where things disintegrate, where these people who loved each other are now at each other's throats, are fighting over everything. So I have a different perspective on marriage, perhaps a broader perspective than the general public might have, because I see the other end. And there you come up with another definition of marriage. What does marriage mean when it goes to court, when you try to divorce somebody? And I think we missed it on the list. There's one thing that dominates court, and that is number 8, financial contract. When you go to court in a divorce case and you and your spouse can't agree on something and you go before the judge, you're arguing about basically two things. You're arguing about child custody and you're arguing about money and property. Child custody, surprisingly, really isn't connected to marriage when you get to the court level. If you are married to someone or you're simply living with someone, it makes no difference to the court. If your name, what does make a difference to the court is your name on a child's birth certificate. So if your name is on a child's birth certificate and the child isn't living with you, you're going to be paying child support. It makes no difference whatsoever if you're married to the person. Your obligations are still the same. So from a legal standpoint, marriage, at least at the divorce end, is not really a parenting contract. Because as far as the law is concerned, if you produce the child, if you produce the gametes to produce the child, you're equally responsible for that child, whether or not you marry the other parent. When it comes down to what divorce means, divorce is a financial contract. And when you're fighting about things in divorce court, you're not fighting about you may think you're fighting about all the bad things that your spouse did to you, but what the judge sees when he's up here on the bench, he's trying to divide up the finances, the real estate, the assets of the marriage. Because little did you know, when you got married, you were entering into a financial contract. Yes, sir, you had a question?
You've never been married?
I have been married, and I'm unmarried. I'm currently unmarried. So, and it only happened once.
And why did you get married?
Same reasons everyone else did. I think it seemed like the thing to do at the time. I think in my mind at the time it was a parenting contract. Yes, sir.
You can just question?
Well, yeah, maybe I can. Well, we need to know. We need who am I? What sort of authority do I have to speak about marriage? Well, unfortunately, no one gets to be a great expert about this because my life is only like so long, and I can only get married so many times, so I'm not claiming that I've been married 6 times, so I can tell you about 6 different... I've been married once. I'm sorry, and unfortunately, it's probably going to be the last time. Actually, I would not be opposed to getting married again, but it would only be for a practical purpose. I would marry someone who I love deeply because health insurance. Because there was an immigration issue, or because I wanted to share my death benefits. That's a reason that I would personally get married. But at the time I got married, I was thinking about all these things. I thought they all went together in a package. It seems so simple. You just take, you just walk down the aisle, you say, I do, and it's all, it's a big package. It's all provided to you. But in divorce court, I see that it's a financial contract. And I'll talk about that in a minute. Do you have something more to say?
It didn't work when you surrounded yourself with a bunch of bad marriages.
Good point. Good point. That is that's certainly true. My marriage was so traumatic to me that I felt I needed to understand. It's like a kid who has is afraid of snakes. So he becomes fascinated with the snakes, and lo and behold, eventually he becomes a snake handler. So, yes, the trauma of my dissolution of my marriage brought me into family court, made me try to understand not just my case, but the whole gamut of cases. So in that sense, I do have some experience. Yes?
You said that you married someone that you loved, and you married them for business. If you're just marrying them for business, why don't you have to love them?
Well, I would do it. For example, if my girlfriend lived in a different country and I wanted to live with her and I wanted to give her things just because I care about her. I'm not, none of this, am I arguing against committed relationships. I believe in committed relationships. I believe that that's where everyone is headed. That's what I think fundamentally is, as human beings, we are kind of pair-bonded creatures. That's the way humans end up. And I think that's natural. I don't object to it. I think you can have a committed relationship that lasts for a lifetime. My argument is you shouldn't at the front end say that it is going to last for a lifetime. Yes, ma'am.
So if you're against marriage, though, why would you have a girlfriend? I mean, it's kind of the same thing.
They're not the same thing. Aren't there people in the world who love each other, who aren't married, who are committed to each other and are not married? You have gay couples who are committed to each other as every bit as much as heterosexual couples are. But in most states, they can't get married. Does that make their relationship any less meaningful?
No, but that's because they actually have a reason and they can't get married in some states.
Yes, but the fact that they don't have that piece of paper diminish their relationship any?
They're fighting for it.
They're fighting for it, but I don't. I think they're fighting for the wrong things. I think that they should. Yes.
I think we can answer many of these questions with another question. Do you see any benefits to marriage compared to a loving, committed relationship that is in the best financial interest of both partners, that fulfills a personal contract, a parenting contract, a social contract, even perhaps a legal contract, a public announcement of her love? Is there any benefit to marriage above and beyond what exists in a equally pleasant and fulfilling relationship outside of the institution of marriage?
I say no. I say there's nothing. For example, gay couples not being able to marry, I think that there's nothing they have that, nothing more that heterosexual couples have that they don't have. They have love, they have commitment, they have, they're sharing property. You know, you don't have to be married to share a house, to both have your names on a house. Ooh. Yes, ma'am.
But they don't have security, and that affects the relationship because there's no...
My question is the security real, or is it an illusion? Is it the right kind of security?
Illusion or not, it's the placebo effect.
Okay.
It is that illusion. That's what I'm saying distinctly. The illusion is what helps to cement the relationship more than stating.
Okay, so I think we got another one, another thing here to add. The placebo effect. So even if it doesn't really mean anything, the fact that people think it means something is going to change the relationship. Yes?
Let me ask you that placebo effect. Maybe it's not a placebo effect.
Placebos really, really help people.
Well, if you're familiar with Ornish's research and Smott's research and all of the research, married people, happily married people.
Stop. Is that one of them?
They do live longer.
Okay.
They are happier, as measured by self-report tests. They have better psychological health. They achieve higher levels of academic achievement, as do their children, who are reared in that particular lifestyle. Their children also enjoy more successful relationships later on in life.
Mm-hmm.
They are financially better off. They achieve more financial stability. And these effects do not translate into other relationships, such as two people that are living in a cohabiting relationship that are happy and gratified.
Uh-huh.
Plus, married people have more sex, contrary to common belief, according to university data. More sex and more gratifying sex.
Mm-hmm.
Now that can be debated, whatever. But the interesting thing to me is that these benefits, placebo or not, don't translate to cohabiting relationships or dating relationships. Mm-hmm. And even people who experience divorce, 75% of men remarry, 66% of women remarry. If marriage is so bad in that all of these benefits to marriage can be achieved outside of the institution of marriage, then why do we ask for more punishment and remarry, and then remarry again and again?
Well, when we get to these items here, there can be some problems with some of this research. You take a couple. How do you compare what's your control sample? For example, people who live longer, people who are married live longer. But that's a coincidence. I mean, that is a...
That's a correlation.
A correlation.
Maybe no cause, not, the correlation is consistent.
It can be consistent. It's possible that different sorts of people get married versus the different kinds of people who do not get married. That doesn't necessarily... And I mean, just to be nitpicking here, if you had a bunch of clones and you could take those clones in a controlled study and expose them to all the same factors all throughout their lives, but marry some of them off and don't marry some of them off, then you'd have a real study. The rest of this is just statistical correlation, and it's not necessarily, strictly speaking, a skeptic will say that's not necessarily true. I tend to stay away from statistics. I'm more interested in logically working things through as to how it applies to you. You're not a statistic. You have a real relationship now, let's say, with a boyfriend or a girlfriend, and you're trying to decide whether marriage is going to help or hurt. That has nothing to do with statistics, I don't think. I think that has to do with whether it's right for you in this circumstance. Yes, sir?
You said you went to Vegas and studied. Did you study any marriages? You're studying only the divorce, the decree, or not the decree, but the dissolvement of the marriage. Have you studied any marriages? I mean, all you're seeing is the bad thing. That's like saying and going to court and saying nothing but a bunch of convicts and saying you hate people because they're all bad, because you're not studying the institution of marriage. You're studying the end of the marriage. So have you studied happy marriages? Have you got with people who have been married a long period of time? Or are you just studying the end?
Well, the nice thing about family court is it's open to the public.
No, that's why. Because most people,
yes.
I've been married 25 years. I haven't been in family court. I'm not divorced. But have you studied people who are still together to get a whole version of marriage, not just the end of it?
For, formally, no. I mean, these marriages just on the street are not accessible to me the way family court is. And family court is attractive because it's open to the public. You can come in and see these marriages disintegrate. But no, I don't have the resources to go out and do a study of average marriages and how they work. But like everyone here in this room, I've seen marriages all around me. I've seen hundreds of marriages. I've seen my parents' marriage. My parents, by the way, have been married, just had their 50th anniversary. Everyone in my family, I was the first one ever to get divorced. I had never experienced divorce until my divorce happened. So in essence, like everyone here, I've seen marriages, you know, you've seen your parents interacted. You've gone to your friends' houses and seen how their parents interact. You know your married friends. You know how their marriages work. So I think we all have a vast body of information about how marriages work. I'm not saying that my parents are unhappy after 50 years of marriage. I'm not saying that my other relatives who got married. I do see in many marriages that I've observed as a citizen, many opportunities lost when people got married, that people were growing on a nice curve like this, and then they get married and they plateau in various ways, that various sorts of personal growth change. I think if we take a nice, cold, hard look at all the marriages around us, we can pick out, okay, that one's working, that one's headed for trouble, that one's not good for the people, even though they think it is. So we have a pretty good body of knowledge of what happens. Let's go to the next person. Yes?
There is a commitment value in marriage that is not present in a cohabitation. And that is important because in communication and in relationships, there's always that element of resistance because it's two separate entities coming together and they'll be classed as, and the opposite usually attracts. The chance of working out problems is more than highly probable in a marriage than it is in a cohabitation.
And I agree. I agree.
And because of that, it fosters stability for raising a family. It fosters stability of staying in a relationship longer. And it makes each person recognize that even though I have my agenda and my spouse or significant other has their agenda, we have to come to a common agenda and we are going to work it out. There's more working out because whenever I think there's an exit door, that's where people today with the me society we have, we want to, if it doesn't suit me, I'm out of it. So we don't stay long enough. Instead, our problem follows us. It doesn't go away into the next relationship and into the next. So marriage provides that stability that is very, it's very essential for our society on a long run basis.
Okay, I agree with what you're saying. Let's put it in different terms, though. If you're coming together with someone solely by free will, then you're free to leave at any time. And yes, if you encounter a problem, you might just run away. It might be easier to just run away from the problem. If you're chained to that person, let's say by a nice 6-foot chain here, and you can't leave that person, yes, you're going to work out your problems. That doesn't mean that in the end you're going to be better off. In other words, let's say you chain two identical couples together so that it's more difficult for them to part. And you take the other two and you don't chain them together. 10 years from now, who's going to be more successful? Who's going to be more fulfilled by whatever standards? It's not necessarily true that the people who have chained together are going to be better off overall, have accomplished more, or by whatever standard you judge, are going to be doing better 10 years from now. They're chained together. Yes, if they're chained together, they're going to work out their problems, but they're also making a lot of compromises, and maybe they're not always good compromises.
Marriage is still, there is still that exit of divorce. It's just that it makes you delay the process.
And divorce is a lot more painful than, yes.
And we are not talking about being chained because marriage is something where there is a lot more happiness, there's a lot more stability. There is a lot more sex because it isn't, I'm afraid I get AIDS or I'm afraid of whatever. I'm afraid of what's the unknown. The point of it is, in a marriage, it's not a chain. The only thing we use enough negative connotation, and we would not want to get married. It's not a chain. Because if it's an abusive situation, you know,
you'll get
it's
out.
Not something that one needs to be in. There is divorce. There is separation. But with the purpose of coming back together, if it is, if both parties could come to a solution or some type of understanding. Being in a marriage doesn't mean that there's no problem. It just means that we think it through a little longer.
Okay. Sir?
The reason why I believe that people try to work things out when they're in a marriage instead of being dating is because you have more stuff invested in a marriage than you do when you're just cohabiting. And it's a lot harder to get out of a marriage than it is when you just date, because you have to divvy up, you have to divide all the financials, the emotion, if you have kids, if you have family, it's all those ties that keep you linked together, regardless if you love that person or not. It's still harder to do it when you're married or not. So I don't think it's because that you love each other. It's just harder to deal with all that stuff when you get divorced instead of just breaking up, because when you're breaking up, it's not that much of a link.
Would it be fair to say that when you're married, you have fewer choices than when you're single?
But you're made to be together with someone.
Okay.
Marriage changes. You can be happy for the first 5 years, and then something happens, so you just get divorced.
That means you're going to have family every year because you are immature and you don't know how to work yourself?
No. It means that marriage is not going to be happy forever, not necessarily.
No,
it's only for some people.
Not only really happy because you're not investing in the marriage.
Okay. Yes, ma'am.
Okay, well, first off, when it comes to marriage, I don't really think that you can say that there's really chains that are, like, holding you down to one person, because nowadays you do have no fault divorce. So if you decide one day that you don't want to be married, you can just get a divorce. So that's something that, I mean, I'm kind of agree with kind of what you're saying about that. But then kind of just going along with that, I'd like to know if it's not, you know, too much of a sore subject why you got divorced.
Between you, me, and the room, my wife went crazy. And now maybe that she thinks I went crazy. But there was a severe mental illness where she thought I was planting video cameras throughout our house and was recording her and had all sorts of affairs that I wasn't having. You know, very paranoid behavior. And it got to the point where I could not live in the house and feel safe, that I wasn't going to be attacked.
Would you agree that that's extreme? Like that's something that's probably not going to happen. Like the probability of it happening to any one of us in this room,
I say the probability is 50-50.
50-50?
I say that. I won't take any more questions. I'll kind of talk about the financial contract, and maybe we'll get into a little bit more and try to answer why I say 50-50. That if you get married, if few people in this room get married, there's a 50-50 chance it's going to end in some real craziness, real insanity.
But the girl could be crazy. I mean, 50-50 is not.
I say that there's something special about marriage that makes people crazy. Well, let me see if I can segue into it. I won't take any more questions for a few minutes. I'll come back to you later. In family court, we find out that all along, as far as the law was concerned, the laws of the state of Florida, of the state of Nevada, where I came from, when you registered your marriage at the courthouse, what you were entering into is a financial contract. Your marriage created something called the marriage, the corporation, I guess you'd call it the community, the marriage community. When you got married, you were creating a new entity. This new entity was not you or your friend. It was the community, the grouping of you. It's just like creating a corporation. You created this new entity called the marriage community. And in Nevada, it's very simple. I don't know how it runs in Florida, but in Nevada, it's very simple. We're something called a community property state, meaning that everything that you earn when you are married, everything that you gain, if you marry, are fortunate enough to marry Paul McCartney, or unfortunate enough to marry Michael Jackson, anything that he makes during your marriage is 50-50 yours. That's the, and essentially, you go out and work, your spouse goes out and work. As far as the law is concerned, everything is going into this community pot. And at least in Nevada, it's regardless of whose name it actually is in. If you have a checking account, it doesn't matter if it's in your name or your spouse's name, technically it's all going into this pot. So when divorce comes along, it's a question of how are we going to divide up this pot. The simplest case is the house. Okay, you get married and you start investing in a house, and maybe your spouse puts in $2,000 a month into the house and you put in $500 a month into the house. When the time comes to divide the house up, it's going to be split right down the middle, at least conceptually. So you've created this new pot. You've essentially erased some of the financial boundaries between you. Now we'll put a pot here. Pot. I guess that's a pot. I don't know. When everything you earn during your marriage is going into this community pot. And at the time of divorce, you have to split this pot in two. And it gets difficult, it gets nasty, because you got something like a house, you can't split it in two. Or you got a car, you can't split it in two. But really, when it comes down to, in a simple case, like in Nevada, it's 50-50. 50-50 division. And you didn't realize this all along. You were keeping your own accounts. You have your bank account and he has his bank account. You didn't realize that you were actually contributing to this 50-50. What? Now, from this pot, you can take some resources out and your spouse can take some resources out. But it's all like a community pot. It's like we're going to pool all of our money, put in a pot, okay, I'll put as much money as I make is going to go into this pot, and I'm going to take out what I need. That's a lot like something we heard in the 20th century, and it was a saying that goes from each according to his needs, from each according to his ability, and to each according to his needs. Otherwise known as the Communist Manifesto. Communism had this really great idea that you could, if we made everything belong to everybody, then we would all be happy, and we would all just take what we need from the pot, and we contribute everything we could to the pot. Now, what happened to communism? What was the fault of communism? The fault of communism over time was that some people kept taking from the pot and not giving anything to the pot. And I argue that once you have erased this financial difference between people, that's what happens in a great majority of marriages. That once you've pooled your resources, each party has less incentive to contribute. They've lost the benefit of their labor. If I'm going to go to work, but everything I do goes into the communal pot, and the other person is going to take what they need from the pot regardless of how hard they work, eventually things are going to be uneven. And I contend that in a vast majority of marriages, the fact that you've taken your separate resources, you started as a separate world, and you suddenly merge your worlds together, you've lost the boundaries that protected each of these worlds. And in that process, you create insanity. You lose the boundaries that protected you. Someone has some comments about that. Yes, ma'am.
Well, in the 50s, a lot of women didn't work.
Yeah.
They stayed at home, they took care of the family, and yet the man would go and work, and he would bring, he was the one who would put in, or as you want to say, the pot. He was the one putting in all that money, but he wasn't saying, you're just taking from me. That was his duty.
Mm-hmm.
Now, because of this world, you have to, things are more expensive, you're both putting in. But how can you relate it, like in marriage back then, you see that the divorce rate was a lot lower back then, and yet you can't say that the like the female was just taking from the husband. That was his duty. He was taking care of his family. So it's not just taking. That was his duty.
And I could see the situation today if a wife chooses to stay home and take care of the kids and forego her career as his husband continues his, yes, he does and should pay alimony to the wife for the sacrifice that she has made for the relationship. Another point.
I'm just saying, you know, not everybody that gets married doesn't mean that they're all gold diggers. And
no.
I mean, there's love, and that is mostly the reason why people get married.
Yes.
There are reasons of, like, immigration and money and everything, but a lot of times it's usually love, and they just want to be together forever.
Right. And I think that you're hurting your love by trying to merge too much. I think there's a point, this is a fundamental problem of human relationships. How much can you merge? And how much is too much?
You can control that, though, within the marriage.
Okay. I think it's a lot easier to control from from outside the marriage simply by controlling your own finances.
But at the same time, though, if everybody takes the easy way out, I mean...
What's the easy way out?
Like,
what's the easy way out?
Like, I mean, then everybody would never, like, nobody would get married ever. I mean...
And what's wrong with that?
I mean, we have to, there's that commitment, and you have to have that commitment. Whether taking it
yes.
too far or not, that's you personally, and that's... you letting that person take over you or over, like, just control, complete control. But you have to control that marriage, and you have to control how you want that marriage to be. But that doesn't mean that it's going to be, like, not successful. Like, you control the success of the marriage, is what I mean. Whether it failed or not, that's your fault.
I think what she's saying is you choose chicken salad or chicken shits.
I think I've heard that. I've heard that one before. Yes, ma'am.
I'd like to elaborate on a point that Sarah made earlier about. I'm sorry, lost my train of thought. She's talking about it doesn't just bring stability, but because you're working out your problems, there is more personal growth. And not just personally is there growth, but as a couple there's growth. And I guess that kind of keys
yes.
into what she was saying as well.
There will be growth no matter what you do. If you're chained to someone, you will
and
grow.
One of the, I mean,
if you're not chained to...
So what's wrong with everybody not getting married? Well... yeah, you can grow on your own, but when you're in a relationship with somebody else, it makes you kind of face to face with your own day. There's your light side of shadow side as we get into another part of psychology, which I won't go there. But you have to, it forces you to face that part of yourself as well when you're with somebody else. Or your projections onto somebody else, it forces you to deal with that as well.
Yes, sir. Yeah,
okay.
Red, man in the red.
I was
Cuban in the red.
Maybe I'm the only one here who comes from a communist country. So
Is he the only one here from a communist country?
Uh-huh.
I think it's fair.
So
communist country.
I really know what that is. And I think the only bad thing with the communist country is that they are forced to be communist.
Mm-hmm.
And if you are forced to give away from what you are getting, so that is a problem. But if you choose to give away because you love someone for the benefit of the team, so there is no problem with that. And if we are a soccer team, for example, just because I think thinking that we are going to split tomorrow is not going to benefit the team.
Uh-huh.
If we are going to be a soccer team, we are all of us, we are going to put as much effort on this team as we can. And if I start thinking that I should be the only one putting all those goals and getting all the applause or whatever, because we are going to split tomorrow and a good team is going to call me and I'm going to be there, that team is not going to make one single goal. If we all work to make goals and win, we all are going to win. And if we think we're going to split tomorrow and everyone's going to try to be someone separately, that's not going to work at all. So community thing is not a 50-50. It's just whatever you... It's 100%.
Okay, that's very good. I agree with you 100% as it applies to soccer. In soccer, you have very clear goals. You're working together as a team to score goals within a framework that is already well established for you. In life in general, doesn't have those clear goals.
But we work as a team everywhere.
But what are you working towards? The thing is, when you're a kid, you're 19 years old, and you join with someone, and you think, oh, this is going to last for a lifetime. At 19, you don't know what the goals of life are. So how can you say that I'm going to work together with this team for the rest of my life when at 19 I don't even know what the goals of life are? No. I think I'm closer. I'm 40. How old am I? 48 now.
So what is your age that you know your goals in life? What do you think?
I say that you never really know your goals in life. And I say that right now...
You're not smarter now than you were at 19.
Oh, I'm smarter. I know the word. I'm smart enough to know. At 19, you are so smug that you know exactly what the rest of your life is going to be. At 48, you're humble enough. At 48, you're humble enough to know, hey, I don't know what's going to happen 5 years down the line. What I've learned... Don't get married.
The problem with your theory up there is you're entering into a business contract, not a financial contract. You're ordered into a business contract where you put the same amount in and you get the same amount out. In a financial contract with a marriage, you don't put the same amount in. My wife cooks, I don't cook. How much is that for her? She does the laundry, I don't do the laundry. So it's not a business contract where you put in, I make more than she does. And so how do you assess what her role is? I mean, it's a marriage. It's one person, and one person make one person. And me and my wife are one. So when it comes up to the contract, you're just splitting it down the middle. I make so much, she makes so much, so she should get it. How do you divide? Well, how much is the child care? How much is her getting up in the middle of the night to be with the kids?
Mm-hmm.
How much is it for her to go to the hospital with the kids while I work? Is just because I bring money into the marriage, is that more valuable than what she brings to the marriage? And you're trying to divide it up like it's all the same, you know, this dollar is this dollar, and it's not. What I bring into the marriage is the money into the marriage, and she brings something else, which is just as valuable. So you can't just come up and say, well, we're going to split it down the middle, it's 50-50, in $500,
no.
And you put in $500, and you get half.
No, this is what, no, you... This is
I understand what you're saying.
This is what happens at divorce.
This person put in this much and this person. You're saying it's a community pot. And you're saying that if I put more money in, I should get more money out. But you're not valuing what she brings to the relationship. You're not valuing what she brings for the child care and to take the kids around and do the soccer mom deal and everything. You said, like communism, everybody puts it in and you take what you need. You're not counting what she can put into the marriage, not necessarily money-wise.
My point in the pot analogy is when you have a community pot, you naturally have the situation. It's just a problem of a system, of any communist system, is that when anyone can put in or take out whatever they want from the pot, there eventually is going to be disequilibrium. There's eventually going to be a situation where one person is taking more and the other one is giving more. That is the core danger of the institution of marriage is that you lose your equilibrium, that you lose the equality between you. And it's exactly what happened in my marriage, and it's exactly what happened in all the marriages I see disintegrate in family court. It's also what I see happening in the large majority of the marriages that I have observed over the course of my life, that there comes to be one party who's more dependent and one becomes the provider. And that this, over time, this disequilibrium becomes larger and larger until, in some cases, it ends in craziness and divorce. But there's a lot of other... Look at all the hands up there. Okay, let's take a few hands.
No, I don't count the marriage. I don't count. She just made a great point. I'm not counting the marriages. What I put in is so much more than my wife puts in. She puts in just as much as I do. She puts in 100% of her life into that marriage, and I put 100% of my life into that marriage. It's not where I make this much and I look at her because she doesn't do this, or she looks at me because I don't do that. We put 100% into the marriage. It's a great point. I mean, I don't look at it. Well, she only works part time.
No.
Well, great, she works part time. I'm glad she works part time, but I don't want to come home and do the dishes.
Do you feel that overall your marriage?
Your marriage, you didn't feel that way either.
Do you feel overall that your marriage is an equal one? Is that you are sharing in an equal way?
Oh, yes. Actually, yes. I think she probably does more than I did.
Okay. And I bet you your marriage works so well that she's going to say that you do more than she does.
Probably so.
Right. And I think that's great. I think it's admirable. My question is would the marriage certificate have changed any of that?
Yes.
No.
Only because the point she made is when things got tough, we didn't say we're just going to split up because we're living together. When things got tough, the marriage certificate made us think that we're married.
I thought your love was keeping you together.
Everything keeps you together, the whole relationship. You're looking at a relationship as just, okay, it's a certificate. It's not. It's a certificate. It's the love. It's the being together. It's the children. That's the marriage.
Yes.
It's not just a financial contract. It's not one thing or the other. It's the whole relationship. But everything binds you together. You'll ask people to their children, keep them to work things out. Is that their certificate? No, it's the children.
Mm-hmm.
It's the love. It's a lot of different things. And you can't just look at it as one thing. Go ahead.
Combined with marriage just makes everything together stronger and more like and peace into one.
Uh-huh.
I think that's what you're trying to say.
Can I give a different perspective?
Yes.
Let's look at the other end of the happiness stuff. When we are at the pinnacle of our youth, we have beauty, we have brains, we have everything. Any man or woman wants us.
Uh-huh.
There comes a time, however, and it may not be what most of the people in this room is, but I am. I'm just around your age. And there comes a time when there is health issues, there's natural, course of the cycle of life will do to you. And the question is, so you're in a cohabitation relationship and you hit a speed bump, a health issue. How likely is a person cohabitating with you, staying with you for better or worse, in sickness and health,
Amen.
Until death do us part, And that's when, if you have a good time in a relationship, the bumpy time with the kids, the up and down, then you level off when they all go off to college and, you could have another honeymoon again if you want to. Your whole marriage should be one. But both parties have to be working on that. And that's why both persons make the choice of being in the marriage, working this together. And I like the thought, if the reason why we are having this discussion today, because the clock is taking 50 and 50, the clock cannot take 50 and 50. The clock needs 100 and 100, because when I work for my overflow, not what I'm only giving, but when I'm filled and I'm working for my overflow, my relationship is solid enough that it's not only good for my family, but it's good for my society, because they have a better role model. And then we should be able to have, that's the reason why our society is falling apart. We don't have those role models. And marriage is a place where our society, from way back to the beginning of time, if you don't want to talk about the Bible, way back from the beginning of time, the institution of marriage is what maintains society and the strength and the prosperity and the sophistication of what we
they want to live long, happy.
Yeah.
Knowing that if I have cancer, my husband would want to be there for me.
Okay. Here's what I'm hearing from you. I'm hearing that you don't trust your husband enough to stick with you when you get cancer.
That's not true.
You need this public contract, this contract from the state of Florida, to trust your husband to stick with you when you get cancer.
Mr. Campbell, I'm sorry that...
I don't mean to talk about you specifically, but
no,
in general, generally...
No, I think I speak for many of us in this room, because I did see... a consensus of some sort at one point or the other. What I'm saying is that when you know that you are, it's not a contract, it's a relationship of where the two persons merge and there's one. The two becomes one.
Yes.
Not just in flesh, but in spirit, in emotion, you know, psychologically. And that bond, it cannot be achieved by cohabitating, because cohabitating, when the two bumps come along, one of us
will
be thrown out of the car, and happily so.
Unhappily so.
Happily so. One person is ready to exit because they didn't have that commitment to the relationship. It all comes back to commitment,
yes.
Cohesion.
And I believe in commitment. I believe in, as I say, I believe in pair bonding. I believe that people, human beings, naturally end up pair bonding. I believe that a sheik who has a harem and can choose from all of the women, of finest women of the kingdom, he will end up with one favorite concubine, because that's the way humans are set up. I think that's a natural process. Let me talk a minute about a bonding. I don't know who is the psychologist. Was it Lorenzo who had little ducklings bonded
to Lorenz.
Lorenz, yes. Okay. Bonding is a natural part of the human brain. In fact, it's part of the brain. When you meet someone and fall in love, that's really bonding taking place. That's the little brain rearranging itself to latch onto that other person and make them part of your world. Essentially, when two human beings bond, they form a bond that's every bit as strong. It's essentially a mother-child bond. When two people, and we know that this falling in love can happen even if it's not really good to us. We can bond to someone who's just a total heel. But this bonding is part of the human brain. It happens at the very deep level of the brain. I don't know what part of the brain it actually happens. But when you bond with someone, and they go away, what happens to you? Where is they? You know, where's mom? But if you're bonded to your soulmate, the person you're in love, you want to be with them. When they go away somewhere for a couple of days, you toss and turn, you want to talk to them on the phone, you're bonded to them. That is part of the human biology. And when you fall in love, all those wonderful feelings that you feel, that's really the little brain inside of you attaching yourself to the other person. So it's like you're attached by an invisible thread. And when you go away from that other person, you want to be with them. You want to call them up. You want to make contact with them again. And that's part of our... And when they're in trouble, you want to help them. When you're bonded to someone, you're as concerned about their well-being as you are about your own. So if I have a girlfriend who I'm close to, I'm concerned about her career as much as I'm concerned about my career, because that's what bonding does to people. That's what the little joining of brains does to people. During the process of bonding, you know, the other person's smell is attractive to you. You bond everything about them, and when they're far away, you want to be back together with them. When they're in trouble, you want to help them. You're concerned about their welfare as much as you're concerned about your own welfare. It has nothing to do with the legal contract with the state of Florida. Sir?
Well, I agree that people can bond and be in love and take care of each other and nurture each other outside of the institution of marriage. They can do it for a lifetime, a ransom. you. I have somebody here now that's with me. I can reap the benefits of marriage and the history of marriage and the history of this person. And your response to that was, don't you trust your partner?
Yes.
Outside of the institution of marriage. I think the real issue here is, do we trust ourselves? If you truly have arrived and you accept a person and you want to choose that person to live with and you truly want to be committed to that person, you respect that person, okay, you have passion for that person, you're honest, why not get married? And the only conclusion that I've come to is that we don't trust ourselves, because if we did and we truly loved that person and we trusted ourselves, then we would get married and say, I know who I am today, I knew who I was yesterday, and I know who I will be tomorrow. And if you don't have the trust in yourself, okay, that is the only reason not to get married. Because now that is giving you a way out, an easy way out.
What you say that I don't agree with, I don't know what I'm going to be tomorrow. Does anyone in this room really?
See, this is the problem.
I know what I was yesterday. I know what I am today.
The problem is marriages don't fail. People fail marriage.
Have I heard that?
Relationships don't
guns
people
don't kill people. People kill.
You do know who you will be tomorrow. You will be tomorrow based on the decision that you make today.
And how does the marriage change what you're going to be tomorrow? How does it change who you're going to be tomorrow?
It absolutely does change who you're going to be tomorrow.
How does it change? I mean, if you're happy and successful in what you're doing, how does the person that you love change what you're going to be tomorrow?
It's going to constrain you in what you're going to be tomorrow.
Well, what are you going to do?
It's going to limit your possibilities for tomorrow.
How does it limit your possibilities? Well, if the person my wife loves me, I can do anything I want to do except for something that is harmful to her, she would support me. Mm-hmm. If I want to go back to school, she would support me. If I want to write a book for the reason for marriage, she would support me. How does being married stop you from doing something that isn't illegal or isn't, you know, it, I mean, how does a person not support you? If my wife supports me, then whatever I want to do, am I supposed to, maybe I want to be a lumberjack and just leave? Is that what you're trying to say? That's why, you know, I'm just going to get up and leave my wife and kids, and if I'm not married, I can do that anyway. But, I mean, you're saying, and if you're going to leave, you didn't love that person anyway.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, you're saying that my wife stops me from being the person who I want to be. She supports me in whatever I want to do. And, you know, if I want to go back to school tomorrow, it would be okay. So I think you kind of missed the point there. But I don't understand how the person that you love stops you from being who you want to be.
I see marriage, because I hang out in family court, I see marriage as a financial contract, and what people have, what holds you down in the relationship is the financial merging. It means
no. But you see marriage, but you see all those people are getting divorced. That's a marriage.
You see the fight over something that we don't fight over.
Yeah.
You see the fight over the end of the marriage.
One hour. You can do it in 1 hour.
Right. You're seeing the worst end of marriage. Okay. Don't assume it's not a healthy state. Nevada is not a healthy state. Okay.
Okay.
How long were you married?
6 years. And it began to disintegrate after a year. And I knew it was disintegrating after a year, but I did everything in my power to try to keep it together. And I really, really wanted to survive. And I fought everything that I did everything I could to try to save my marriage, try to get treatment for my wife. I was absolutely committed to my marriage and absolutely committed to my wife. And all this stuff about...
Did you live and you learned?
Yes. If you talked to me 5 years ago, there's no way I would be making this lecture today.
Okay, so
I believed in marriage. Begin to go bad the day we got married, because the nature of the relationship changed.
After a year.
What's that?
You said it didn't start deteriorating until after a year.
A year after the marriage.
Yeah, exactly.
So I knew this person for 5 years. We got married, and on our first wedding anniversary, that's the first big screaming match.
Okay, so lasted a whole year. But
yes, it was a great relationship there. Okay. I think you deserve a good relationship. Above all, you deserve a good man or woman or whatever. You deserve a good relationship. And that's what's important, this good relationship. Let's talk about what a good relationship is. Put your hands down for about 5 minutes. What is a good relationship? What do we expect out of a good relationship? On a daily basis, is it?
It depends. If you're a guy, you spend mistakes. If you're a girl, you spend a lot.
We've all got this sexual urge. At least everyone I know is a sexual being. We are attracted to the opposite sex or the same sex, and we can't change that. We are going to be drawn to those other people no matter what. Okay, you can say that, oh, I'm not a sexual being. I think you're lying. I think that we're all drawn to be with someone. And that, of course, evolution, in terms of evolution, that's the reason for that is for procreation. Human beings, men and women, are drawn to each other. They have to do this little mating dance before they get together. But it's programmed into us by evolution, because that's the way that we procreate. And the man and the woman have to dance around each other before they get together, because you want to see, is her genes right? Is she healthy? Is she going to give me? Is he going to give me good a good offspring, etc.? And this is programmed into us, and we are also programmed in as pair bonded creatures. When a man and a woman get together and they get along, they're going to stay together. You know, cavemen, when the caveman went out and slaughtered woolly mammoths and brought it home to the, you know, he did that because he's emotionally bonded to that woman. Regardless, you know, no modern institution of marriage needs to do that. People do that. If this is going to happen to you, if you're going to be drawn to the opposite sex, you might as well get somebody that you get along with, You might as well get somebody who you're going to, that you have something in relation, in common with, and if you're going to be drawn to someone, you might as well have a nice productive partnership. You might as well have something that works on a lot of different levels. Let me give you my love advice as to who you should choose. I'm going to switch hats here for a moment and tell you who you should fall in love with. There are two schools of thought here. One is opposites attract, and the other school of thought is you should get someone exactly like you or as close to you as possible. So which school of thought is the best one? Opposites attract say, oh, you see someone from a totally different culture and totally different than your upbringing, and you're drawn to them, and you think that that's the relationship that's going to work for you. And the getting someone just like you is you look across the room and you see that special someone who is exactly like your mother, exactly like what you grew up with, had the same sort of experiences you had when growing up. Which kind of marriage works? Which kind of relationship works best? And you can pay me for this advice later. You want to get somebody who's as close to you as possible.
Why?
What
do you have to offer?
Are you looking for a friend? Are you looking for
someone you have? Since you're going to be drawn to this person, since you are going to be drawn to someone of the opposite sex, I want you to look for someone who totally understands your language. Okay? This other person has a different, inevitably it's going to have a different perspective, might come from a different culture. But the important thing is you have that common language at the beginning. If you choose somebody who's totally different from you, you're not going to have the common language, and the relationship is more likely not to work. I chose the opposite. That was my fault. Now I'm looking for someone who's like, a clone of me, maybe female.
Well, you look for somebody who believes that you're the man who's going to be there, but you're not going to be married. What did you say you
want
to be married?
Did I say I wanted to be married?
Yeah.
You said you would look to be married again.
Yeah.
I would do it for business relations. For example, a very good friend of mine has been living with her boyfriend for 15 years. They're totally committed to each other. Recently, they got married. Why did they get married? For health insurance. Okay? Yes, sir.
I just want to start off by saying I'm unfamiliar with your book, but
okay.
By the title, I see the argument of the title would be quite deceiving. The argument against marriage isn't, I don't think it's against love. And it's not against the relationship at all. The point, I feel that, I don't want to say people are missing the point, but it's against what marriage has become. And if you take a look at history, and if you take a look at the financial contract and the legal contract involved in marriage, wouldn't you say that your definition of what a marriage is being somewhat manipulated by society? You're giving back to society by getting married. It isn't like society projecting some kind of blissful image of this relationship that is marriage. I'm not saying I'm against marriage, but I'm saying I do have problems with what marriage has become. The whole financial pot thing is like, it can swing both ways. People can be perfectly comfortable with that, but again, I see the complications, and you can't divide things evenly, and there is no equilibrium. But the stipulations placed onto marriage in our most recent history of it are phenomenal, and I feel like it's taking away from the bond of love that people feel is there. And you need to stop kind of subjectifying the argument and to saying your point in terms of yourself and look objectively at an argument in a case against marriage. He's not saying he's against marriage, but he's providing a case against marriage. And it's just basically pointing out the different sections that are distorted from the common belief of what marriage is.
So when you start talking about I have this and you're in marriage and
to our own home until we settle our differences. Did you not? You wrote that down.
I agree.
The doctor told me. but that's not a case against that. You are discouraging folks by saying, keep as much individualism with your, all to yourself, but just be a weak. But there's no honor on it.
Generally, and not really relating to the book, I'm just saying I want people to really see there is a problem with modern day marriage. I feel have to sign up for that financial contract? Yes. Would you sign that legal contract? Yes. But it's an establishment that has traditionally been passed down through the ages, and it has become more and more corrupt. In medieval times, how do you think marriages worked? They used to marry in their own class, and they used to marry...
There was nothing
but still, do you not see the similarities in today's society? I understand it's a question of technology and tradition, but the way it has evolved really... does have some fundamental problems with it. And marriage, I believe in love, and I believe in relationships, and I believe that marriage should, in circumstances, continue, but I just don't believe that now, like, it is what it used, like, what it's supposed to be. Yeah, it's society, it's not marriage, it is society. But I'm just saying that because society has changed marriage, it has affected marriage. Like, not fundamentally... Well, no, it's not... I'm understanding you want to drive it home, but here's the fact. The fact is that marriage is now directly connected to the financial contract and the legal contract. I'm foreign, too. And, like...
From a communist country?
I'm from England.
Oh, a communist country.
Kind of, sort of. But just, like, my family is currently through the process of immigration... And I get whispers all the time. You should get married to stay here. You should get married. I'm like, no, I've told myself morally I don't want to do that. I don't even know if I want to get married because of what it's become. But I know I don't want to marry for the, like, legal citizenship.
But if you want to get married for legal citizenship, you should, and that's the wrong reason, so you don't even think about it because you're going to fail.
Well, exactly. That's why I'm not thinking about it.
Okay, one more question, then we'll get back to it. Yes.
Okay, I've been holding hands for a long time. Okay, I honestly believe that it's not the institution of marriage, it is the individual that is in the marriage itself that is the problem. You have someone that sees someone and they're so infatuated with it that they let their emotions overwhelm them and they don't think about the future. What this person wants or what they want out of the relationship, they just see the immediate and they don't see far ahead in the future. So you get in this relationship thinking that it's something that it's really not, and then when reality hits you, you start feeling trapped because you are in a relationship, you are in a marriage, you can't just walk away then. And so that's where I think where the bad marriages happen. Where the good marriages happen is you said the opposite attract and get the same people. I think that it needs to be a middle ground. Example, me and my girlfriend. Physically, day and night. We are physically day
and night. Okay, but
mentally, we are day and night. We have common ground. We have things that we like, and we have total things that we dislike about each other. I love warm weather. She loves cold weather.
Okay.
So we have common ground and we have differences. It's all in the communication and how much you actually care for the person. And people that say that, people that are in cohabitating relationships won't stay for health reasons or blah, blah, blah. That's bullshit. Excuse my language. She has a heart condition. I've been with her for 3 years. We're cohabitating with each other.
Our
financials are tied. We have the same bank account. We know each other's email addresses, everything.
Okay, wait, whoa, whoa, hold. You're not married.
We're not married.
And you're happy.
We just celebrated three years. We started off the relationship 6 days before we started dating. Her father passed. The month after that, she got kicked out of the house. 2 months after that, I got kicked out of the house. We were living with each other homeless. So to say that people that run into bumps are just going to run away, that's bullshit because we haven't. And it's not because we We have our own apartment. We have a vehicle. We're both looking for jobs. I'm getting ready to go to school. She's passing with straight A's in school. We have a dog together. So people that say that it doesn't work, it does work. It just has to, what do you want out of the relationship? You don't make decisions off of an emotion. You make decisions off of your common sense and off of knowledge that you already know.
So why are you married?
Because Amanda has goals and I have goals, and I don't want a relationship between us to interrupt what we have planned.
You agree with him?
No, I don't agree with him because it's all about. No, it's all about people rush into relationships, and I think that's the problem. People rush into relationships. Well, if you've been with each other three years, why don't you get married? Because it's not the right time. The Bible says it's time and season for everything. And right now, it's not the time nor the season for us. Because if we were to get married, there's a lot of financial things that you have to deal with. And right now, we can't do it. We can't afford to get married. Plain and simple. Emotionally, we've stressed out. I'm trying to get my life together. She's trying to get her life together. And we can't do that plus deal with the problems that we already have. And on top of that, getting married. So we have to get ourselves straight individually, plus as a couple, before we get married. We're not going to go all willy-nilly. Because once you marry me, that's for any woman. Once you get married to me, done. It's a wrap. So that's why we haven't decided to get married yet, because we're taking our time and we're learning each other, plus learning ourselves. I'm 25, she's 22. We don't know ourselves, so how are we going to dedicate our lives to someone else if we don't know ourselves?
Right.
So it's not that I'm disagreeing or agreeing with him. I have my own plans. She has her own plans. We have plans with each other. It's just that this is not the time nor the place to do it right now.
Okay. Very good. And I think that in your position now is, this life is throwing so much shit at you anyway. Let's just, enjoy the relationship for what it is between us right now. That life is so damn complicated, we don't need to complicate it with something else that's going to complicate it more. You had an issue?
I agree with him on the aspect of that you can't go to the extreme of saying, oh, you have to find someone identical to you, and you can't go to the extreme of saying, oh, we have to find someone that's exactly opposite. You have to find a middle ground, someone that has your same.
As long as you have the common language.
Your moral beliefs, what you believe, But, it's different that you can share.
Yeah, you want, if you're going to have this relationship, you want their
debate with or something.
Yeah, you want you want a different perspective. You want somebody who's going to add to you.
Correct.
But you don't want them to be so radically different that you don't have this common language that you thoroughly understand each other. So, okay, I'll give you that. Let's stop for a minute. I want to talk about what was marriage. Where did marriage come from? Marriage was invented. Well, every culture has it. But the kind of walking down the aisle marriage and with the flower girls and all this and the best man and the maid of honor, that's all a medieval. It all comes from the dark ages. It comes from the medieval times. Back in those days, in the days when marriage was invented, things were radically different than what they are today. There was no contraception. If you had sex with someone, you're going to produce offspring. People's lives were very short. People's lives were very stable. If you grew up, if you were born in a village, you're going to spend the rest of your life in your village. If your father was a blacksmith, you're going to become a blacksmith. Things were a lot different then than they are now. And you can argue, I would not be giving this talk in the 15th century because it would be absurd. Marriage was absolutely essential in the 15th century because society and families needed to control how people are reproducing, how society had an interest in seeing that that when a man and woman got together and started raising children, that one of them didn't take off. there certainly was the necessity there to control how people procreated, to make sure that you went through all the hoops before you walked down this aisle. And back in the 15th century, there's no such thing as divorce either. Lives were very short back in those days. When you walked down the aisle and you said, "Till death do you part," that might not have been very far in the future. You know, 10 years. You know, life expectancy back in medieval times was maybe 10 years. Now, when you walk down the aisle and you say, "Till death do you part," whoo, you could be talking 75 years. So things have changed quite a bit. This institution that was created for medieval times, where there's no contraception, where things were stable, where life was short, where society was extremely regimented and stable, that's where we created this whole idea of walking down the aisle, the whole idea of marriage. Question is, things have changed. We have contraception. The child-rearing function has been separated now from the financial contract. Now, under the law, parenting has nothing to do with marriage. Marriage has nothing to do with parenting. The controlling document in parenting is the birth certificate. Now, if you give birth, if you provide the sperm or the egg to produce this child, you are financially responsible. You are equally responsible. And you have equal rights, regardless of whether you're married. So my question is, what is an institution that was created in medieval times appropriate for today? Let's think about this. As I say, I'm losing this argument already. But let's just think about what life would be like without it, without marriage. And we have a perfect model in that. In gay relationships, they have to live their lives in most states, now in California even. Gay couples can be completely committed to each other, but they don't have the privilege of marriage. And they're fighting like hell to get the privilege of marriage. And I say, wait, look at all you've got. Let's not race into this. What happens when a gay couple gets together? Well, they start sharing things, but they share them at their own discretion. Okay, let's buy a house together. We'll put our names on a house and let's buy this house together. We'll select the house together. We'll make it together. They've made that choice. They make another choice. Okay, shall I put you in my will? If I die, I'm worried about you, so let me put you in my will. I'm concerned about your health, so let's get health. Let me see if I can get health insurance. Unfortunately, in many states, you can do that. But what gay couples are forced to do is obtain the same services of marriage a la carte. Instead of walking down the aisle on one day and doing everything all at once, they have to make a conscious choice about everything they do. And this is what I'm arguing for. And what they're going to have at the end, after they've made these series of conscious choices, they're going to have something that looks very much like marriage. But instead of doing it all at once, they thought everything through step by step by step. Right, and I think that's a great advantage.
If they could get married, I'm sure they would be just like regular married couples.
No, I think you say by doing things, by making a conscious decision, a free will decision about every step in the process, you're coming to a better quality marriage, a better marriage than you would if you just walked down the aisle in front of all your friends and did it in one fell swoop.
I want
you to have the best relationship possible. And to do that, you have to do it consciously with your brain, according to what really works. Not just kind of what, you know, you hear this a lot in when people talk about marriage. You just have to close your eyes and jump. And I'm saying no. I want you to take every step. You take what marriage is, and right now if you're heterosexual, you might want to just jump into it and think, okay, we'll just walk down the aisle and let's take care of everything. I'm saying, let's take marriage, break it into its component parts, and look at each one individually and make a conscious, intelligent, well-reasoned decision about what we're going
to
do.
What marriage, what it used to be, why it works in large part, and why it doesn't work today is because of what has changed, is that not that we took marriage, we married by degree. That is a modern-day solution that is recommended by certain special interest groups, is to marry by degree to increase the success of marriage. Meaning, let's not marry permanently, let's have a one-year contract in marriage, or let's operationally define in legal terms what is involved in the marriage in terms of our responsibilities or whatever, and then we can add to that as we go along. But the why that seems to be necessary and so attractive to many special interest groups is because we're not doing what we did before, and that is to prepare ourselves. We know people were prepared for marriage. We don't prepare ourselves for marriage. We prepare ourselves for careers. The focus here is on the individual, on self-actualization. That's even the major focus in marriage counseling, is not to prepare the marriage, it's to build the self-esteem and the self-concept of two individuals. And that's why I was about thrown out of a conference one time when I said one of the leading causes of divorce is marriage counseling. What has changed, because it's too humanistic, what has changed is in decades past, young people used to date before marriage. And the purpose of the date, the political and societal significance of the date, was to get to spend more time with each other, to learn about each other, to stick our toes in the water, so to speak, to determine what your attitudinal focus was. Do we have similar attitudes? What are our differences? Are you a viable candidate? Do I want to continue this relationship? Do I want to escalate it to the next level?
Sort of like a series of job interviews.
Exactly. And that's just the stepwise fashion that you're talking about that we should incorporate in marriage. We did those things before getting married. Mm-hmm. We don't do that now. The date, the societal significance of the date is not to get to know our partner. The societal significance of the date is sex, is what it is. So what happens is we have people, and albeit not as young as they were decades ago when they enter into marriage, they enter into marriage, they're blind because they don't know themselves, they don't know what to look for in terms of a viable candidate, in terms of qualities, and a partner. And I am even surprised that marriage is as successful as it is, given the skill set that these young people enter into marriage. We teach reading, writing, arithmetic, but we don't teach relationships anymore.
Okay.
We don't, formally, we don't teach it in the family because we don't have time. We enter into marriage without the requisite skills to make it work. And
uh-huh.
Life fails.
Wait, hands down for a minute. take the job. You'll be next. I promise. You'll be next. Don't even have to raise your. Keep your hands down. I'll remember you. Let's talk about the job interview analogy. Back in my mother's day, the 1950s, you dated, you got to know the person. You didn't have sex, because sex was reserved for after marriage. And when you really felt that you know this person well enough, after 2 years of dating, you would get married. The trouble is, it's all like an extended job interview. You can interview with... You can go into a company interview with one person, he likes you, another person he likes you, go up to the vice president, he likes you, and then you get hired. But the real proof of the pudding is how you perform after you're hired. And no amount of dating is going to prepare you for what really hits when you get married if you do it in one unit. I say that, dating per se doesn't work as much as operational experience. Before you get married, let's try combining some of our assets. Let's try buying a house together. See how that works. I say, let's escalate into marriage, escalate into something that looks like marriage rather than taking it in one gulp. Because the only test of an employee is how he actually, or a spouse, is how he actually performs in the field, in the job that, the real job of the marriage.
Okay, but couples who cohabitate double the likelihood of divorce.
Sure. I've heard that. That's just one of those. That's just another one. Another one.
But
yes.
He doesn't even think so.
But in couples are saying, we cohabitate because we want to take this relationship to the next level, and before we get married, we want to take it to one more degree to see if we are compatible, and yet 50% of relationships break up.
And I think these are false statistics. I believe, no, you don't have a control group. In other words, the kind of people who cohabitate may be entirely different in personality and goals than the kind of people who get married. You're talking about apples, could be talking about apples and oranges.
But it's still fruit.
That's right, I heard that. that was on a movie we saw this morning.
But you have to understand that sexual commitment, even faithfulness, is not as easily, readily available in a cohabitation relationship as it is in a marriage, too. Because if let me ask you just a general question. So you were at a bar, and someone came up to you, and you were in a steady, according to you, cohabitation relationship.
Yes.
And so there's an attractive woman who has everything that in your mind you think is going for her. And she comes up to you and asks you, so tell me something, Glenn, are you married?
Yes, right.
You see, the answer would always be no, and then you would say, well, that's the truth, but you didn't go on to qualify. Yes, I'm married, but I'm living
I have confidence enough in that the word that I use, you know, if I'm committed to someone, I can say, I have a boyfriend. I have a girlfriend. I can say...
That's okay, I'm not a Freudian.
I can say, you know, I can, you know, if someone's making moves on me, and darn it, I wish someone would make moves. I can let it be known that I am attached to someone else. I don't have to have a ring on my finger. I might actually put on a ring if I felt that, for example, if I felt that I was a woman and too many men were hitting on me, and I have a boyfriend who I'm committed to, I might just get a ring at Walmart and put on my finger just to keep those suckers away. But the ring isn't necessary. The word marriage isn't necessary. What is necessary in your heart is whether you're committed to this person. And you know, it's not very hard. If you have common, once you get with someone for an extended period, you have so much in common that anyone else just isn't an issue. If the marriage, if the relationship is really working, really meshing together, where to the point where you're talking in this language, you might still be talking English, but you can share things with this person that you can't share with anyone else, where you've made investments with this person that you haven't made with anyone else, it doesn't matter who comes up to you in a bar. I'm not going to take the bait. And it doesn't matter whether I don't have to say them. Maybe I might lie just to get rid of this jerk. But it doesn't matter whether I say I'm married or I have a ring on my finger. I know, because I have confidence in myself, I have confidence in my relationship, that I'm not going to go for this other person because, you know, I've already developed such this rapport with my partner, and we have a partnership where we're sharing not just sex, but a lot of other things. Then other people just aren't an issue because they don't have all that we have together already. So this isn't going to be a temptation for me. Yes.
Okay. I have three questions.
I'm sorry. Yes.
No.
Did you cohabitate with your wife in the 5 years you were with her before you were married?
No. For about 6 months.
Okay.
So we knew each other. We knew each other for 5 years, but we cohabitated for about 6 months.
Before you're married.
Right. And we got married because she had a lot of kids, and we wanted to buy a house together, and my feeling was is that that's what people do when they have a lot of kids, because you need this base for raising the kids.
Not to attack you or anything, but do you think
please.
Because you don't really so much believe in dad, you're more like humanistic ideas of things, that maybe it's not dad, maybe it's just coincidence that after a year that 50% of marriages break up, or 50% of cohabitating couples break up or get married in the first 2 years. Do you think that maybe it was coincidence, or do you think that maybe you just fell in the category and you got divorced? You said you first
started having problems
1 year after you got married. Yes. Do you think that's maybe the coincidence with the statistics that Dr. Morrison was talking about earlier, where 50% of cohabitating couples break up or get married in the first 2 years? Does that make sense?
No.
Okay. You cohabitated, and that's the reason why you got divorced after a year, because you cohabitated, and that's one of the things that leads, statistics say that that's what leads to a divorce within the first year.
That was when the problems began. Do you think that maybe that
had
a causal factor?
It's really hard to find anyone today who hasn't cohabitated before getting married.
The reason why
it's really hard.
People get rushed into marriage because they're cohabitating, and people come up and say, why don't you get married? Why don't you get married? So after a while, they just feel that they need to get married before it's time for them to get married. That's the reason why. That's my honest belief.
Can I ask my last question?
Yes, go. I never talk statistics. I never talk about what bunches of people do. I don't care what the rest of the universe does.
Right.
I don't care, you know, what's good for a million other people in America. I care about my relationship right now and what's right for that relationship right now. I know lots of people who are happily married.
Right.
Okay? Who will probably live longer because they were married. Who will probably be happier, higher achievement. Maybe they're richer. Maybe that works for them. I say that for me and you, that isn't relevant. What's relevant to me and you is my life and what's going to be best and healthiest for my life, and most importantly, what's going to be best and healthiest for this relationship. If you really value this relationship, what's the best thing to do? When people are bonded, they naturally start thinking we. Mm-hmm. I'm attached to someone, I'm concerned about her career as much as I'm concerned about mine.
That's not why you're writing your book.
I have no idea what I wrote in my book. That was 2 years ago. I spit it out. I put it on the internet.
We should have, our own space, and we should be able to move on whenever we want. And if that's the case, I can date 2 girls today, and what happens if one of you have a girl and your daughter, and I want to date your daughter? Will you be happy with me dating your daughter because I just move on every time I want, and I just have a girl every day, and I'm going to date your daughter tomorrow? Will you
I
be
think
happy?
That's my daughter's decision.
But will you be okay with that?
I'm going to tell my daughter, you're a cat. You're a cat, I'm going to tell
you. If I am thinking the way you write in your book,
okay.
I'm going to date a girl a day, or maybe 3 a day.
No.
Yeah, because I'm ready to move on. I just got tired of her. I did what I had to do. I did my business, and then I'm going to move on.
Uh-huh.
I'm with a new girl every day, or maybe 3 a day. And I want to date your daughter. What do you think about it?
I don't recall.
Do you let me date your daughter?
I don't recall saying anything like that in my book. But who am I?
You
I'm just the author.
Something about that you need to be. You need to have space, and you got to move on whenever you want.
I'm talking about freedom.
You don't enter in a marriage to have freedom.
Right. No, freedom. Oh, freedom is the ability to make decisions. It's the freedom to say, when you have a lot of freedom, you have a lot of choices. That doesn't mean you make all those choices. If you have the choice of a whole range of of other men or women, and you keep coming back to that same person, that's true freedom. That means that you really have that bond, that you really have things in common with that person. You do not have freedom if you're both trapped in the same cell together. That's not freedom. If you're chained to someone, or you're in a desert.
You chose that chain. You chose that jail. When you're incarcerated, it's not your choice, or else you wouldn't be there. It's freedom.
You made that choice.
You chose.
Right? But 5 years down the line, when your finances are totally merged, and financially you can't get out of the marriage, it's extremely painful to go through divorce, and you look at your partner and you say, am I here because we love each other, because we really work, or am I here because I'm trapped?
You chose to enter an institution in which you knew
that doesn't
you would have to be there forever, or don't get married.
That doesn't change the fact that 5 years down the line, you could still feel trapped.
So have some fucking accountability.
I don't want that fucking language in there. Yes.
Okay, so what you were saying before, too, about a gay marriage, that because they can't get married and because they're just cohabitating, they start to gradually start to merge their, their finances.
Yes.
So then it's like a cohabitating community instead of a marriage community. So what happens when that fails? And their names are both on that house. What happens then? What happens when they start making each other the beneficiary of each other's accounts? What happens then? You know, or just let's think of a heterosexual relationship. And what happens if they're cohabitating and they're merging everything? Their car payments are together. And they're just doing this gradually. And then we get to about 15 years. And they've had sex, right? But they're not planning on getting married. And I don't know how many of you know what oxytocin is, but oxytocin is this hormone or something that women produce in their body that when she gives birth to a baby, that's what bonds the mom to the baby. Mm. It's the same thing that happens during sex. So even if you're cohabitating and you don't get married, if you split up, you've already bonded with that person sexually, so that's going to hurt. And then if you're going gradually and building up your finances together, when you start to part, isn't that court is about? Is that when it gets unbearable and there's no other way out and you have to split, that's someone who can split it for you in an even keel way that you're not trying to cause war, but it's just not working. I don't think if you're cohabitating and you decide that you have to split, how do you do that evenly? Do you go to a court and do you say, well, you know, we're cohabitating, help us split this?
And you have a good point. By getting married, you automatically engage, can take advantage of the divorce system. When you get married, am I missing the point?
I think what I'm not understanding, and I mean I don't know how many other people aren't understanding, but what you're basically saying is that don't just do it all at once. Which I agree that if you court with someone and you get to know who they are, you'll know from the beginning whether or not they're good at managing finances.
Yes.
You'll know whether or not they're a good listener, if they're good at communication. You choose to avoid, to not pay attention to those things.
Mm-hmm.
But as you're going on throughout the relationship, and if you're just cohabitating and you're putting all these things into this community pot without the word marriage, it's still a community pot, and it's still going to be ugly if something happens.
But not as ugly.
And act like if you get married, you're adding ugliness to the issue.
Mm-hmm.
That's what I think your point is.
Exactly. When you decide that you don't want to go into a marriage because you don't want this marriage process to break up in a bad way, and you don't want to have to go into a failing court to get divorced because you don't want all these assets to split apart, well, then you're setting yourself up for failure.
Uh-huh.
Because you're already thinking about the end before it's even begun. And what you were saying about walking down the aisle and all that stuff, that's the wedding ceremony, that's not the marriage. So that's two completely different things. So I'm not sure how you're trying to put those together, because if I get married with just one witness, then that's different. And that's just the wedding ceremony, that's how it's presented, but the marriage is a completely different thing. And if you're not in it 100%, then it's not going to work. Same thing with cohabitating.
Uh-huh.
So I don't really understand where you're getting this case against marriage, because what you're talking about in cohabitating, you're saying the exact same thing, just taking a long time, which nowadays we don't do that.
I think this whole debate, the whole debate we're having, have had for the past hour and a half, is because our definitions of marriage are different. What I think marriage is and what you think, most of you think marriage is different. I think we're trying to hammer out a definition. I just say, you know, in essence, I believe in marriage. I don't believe in the contract that you're making with the state of Florida. I don't believe in the... I don't believe the government should be involved in our marriage, in your marriage.
So you're saying the only reason why you would get married again is to involve the government in your marriage,
exactly,
for immigration or business.
Right, and I have to think...
If you're so against it, why is it the only reason you would ever get married again? You must love it.
No, I'm talking about some substantial benefit, and the reason, the primary one nowadays is health insurance. Okay, health insurance is a huge expense, a huge monthly expense. If you're with a company, you can get cut-rate health insurance for your spouse, but not your cohabitant. Okay, and so we're talking. But you're talking. Well, I would not.
You have a business arrangement, but you got great health coverage.
I would do it only with someone. I would not do it for purely immigration purposes. I would do it only with someone I thoroughly trusted.
Okay, but
in essence, I already had the marriage with.
On a business level, though. So if you're dying, you have to look at that arrangement as a business arrangement as opposed to someone actually truly looking at you and saying, you know, I love you and I'm going to take care of you.
I think that we've already said that to each other anyway. I say that all these things that we associate with marriage, this commitment, have nothing to do with the state of Florida. I think it has everything to do with what we said to each other. Nothing to do with what we say before our family and friends. It has to do with what we say to each other. There's nothing wrong with you and I talking about saying we're committed to each other. You know, I spent 2 years with you. You know, you're everything I want. I really want this to last. I'm really committed. I want you to know I'm really committed to you. It's between me and you. That's what really counts. It's not what's between me, you, and the state of Florida. It's not what's between me, you, and all our friends and relatives. It's what's between me and you that's what it's important. And if you involve the friends and relatives, and if you involve the state of Florida, you're complicating what's really important between me and you.
How possible are you complicating, or are you understanding that's a legal obligation that you have to have?
But I trust you so much that I believe that thick and thin we're going to stay together. I trust you so much that we're going to, that I don't need the state of Florida. I don't want the state of Florida.
You don't even know yourself. Like, we are not perfect. We don't even know each other. Like, we make mistakes all the time.
Uh-huh.
And I don't think there is nothing wrong having a ring in my hand and say, oh, I'm married. Like, something that reminds me that I'm married. Because we are not perfect. Promise because I know it's the good of my family and it's good for me.
But if something is done, if sometimes someone is suffering in the marriage, so I mean, you should split up. But if not, I mean, then if there is a child in the middle, you should speak to that. I think so. Like, if we look at a statistic, and you said something about a statistic, what is the difference between a hypothesis and a fact? It's just that I can do it over and over and over, the same thing, mm-hmm. and then have the same result. Unfortunately, we can't do that with marriage. But let's go to economics. Economics is a bunch of data that we have from the past that we use it to predict the future.
Uh-huh.
And then we should say, oh, economics. That's
okay.
Economics.
Now, what's happened in economics just recently?
So you're talking two different things.
No.
I'm just saying economics is the study of like how we solve the things.
Uh-huh.
But we use data from the past to predict what's going on and how we can solve this problem.
Okay.
And then what we do with economics is we don't have a way that we say, okay, we have to do it this way. But we can use the data from the past to get the best way to solve the problem. And that's how economics works. And economics, that is a lot of people who get money to just do economics. I mean, if that doesn't work, we should just fight all those people, but we are keeping them.
But before people start drifting off, check my website and friend me on Facebook.
Just that's my point. Like we shouldn't just ignore statistics because they are not they don't prove the hypothesis and they are not the same. But like economics, they use data from the past to predict how to solve problems in the present. We can use data from the past in real life and predict what's going on. Because you have to agree that children who grow up in a family of father and mother are more healthy than people than two kids that grow up only with one parent.
I live in a family of father and mother. My parents didn't get married until I was like 10. But let me tell you, with marriage, there's a blueprint. That's what I like to call the blueprint. It didn't just come about. I mean, there we have an original plan of how marriage is originally looked.
Uh-huh.
The plan was modified through the process of the years and people and the way they're adding and subtracting and things. I think of it as like building a house. You start off with a foundation of clay and think you're going to end up with the same type of foundation as you have with concrete, is not the same thing. I mean, what you're basically talking about, especially with your a la carte thing, that's for a meal. And a meal in a marriage is not the same thing. And then secondly, with the a la carte thing, to me, it's like you're saying, you know what, I like that person's breath, but I like that person's brain. How can I put those two together? You can't do that because you know what happens when you go in the grocery store, there's a food that everybody desires and there's a food that everybody doesn't want. What happens to the food that everybody doesn't want? It just sits there and rots. You can't have this a la carte perspective. Everybody is going to want the steak. Okay, who the hell is going to want the steak except the people that don't eat steak?
I'm talking about a la carte between us.
If you're talking about a meal in a marriage and choosing things a la carte, you can't just, this is not the cafe where you go down and say, I want the jello, I want the steak, I want the mashed potatoes, but I don't want the green beans, and I don't want this. You don't have a choice in doing that. There's a yin and a yang to everything. If you got the brains and the boobs, you might not have the personality. You know what I'm saying? I mean, it's just waves like that, and then you can't just say, because that person has an ugly face, they have a great personality, I don't like that ugly face, let me just move on.
Okay,
if you're dating or if you're not sexually attracted to that, then that's fine. But when you start talking about people's personal things, love, I think, is not the thing, and marriage, I believe, is not the thing that you love about someone that draws you to them. It's loving to love the things you don't like about them. Learning to love the things that you really dislike, like the fact that they, you know, leave their socks in the middle of the floor. Learning to love the things that you do not like about the person is really what I feel love is. It's easy to love, to have someone that's just like you and love that you guys go to movies and love that you like the same car and love that you like the same home. And yes, you have these great expectations for your relationship. But what about the things you don't like about that person? Are you willing to trade those things in for
whether you're married or not, you have, what I'm talking about, a la carte, I mean, between two people, I want you to decide what you're going to share, okay? Tonight, we're going to a restaurant, and who's going to pay? Well, I paid last time, I think I'll pay this time. You'll pay, you know. I want you to negotiate things on an individual basis. So that's why I'm saying, you don't have to share everything. No relationship do you share everything. You have to make a decision, even if you're married, okay, this is my room, this is my stuff, this is your stuff. You have to decide what it is you're going to share. And I think it's much easier to make those conscious decisions if you don't have the piece of paper from the
But
the
your
paper.
Conclusion is that gay couples are happier because they're making
a hard decision? See, I don't care about that.
You said the gay couples were happier in their relationships because they got to two things a la carte.
No, I didn't say they were happy. I said that they're better. I say that they're better off.
What do you mean by better off?
They have more freedom. They have, no, I don't know statistically, and we can't even figure it out, possibly. But, you know, can you say that gay couples are less happy than heterosexuals because they don't have access
but
to
gay,
marriage.
Gay,
I don't know how many gay people you know, but I have a lot of gay friends,
okay.
A lot of gay guys. I'm not talking about lesbians, I'm talking about homosexuals. And they are the most philandering, cheating, unhappy friends ever met.
And
they are not happy at all. Their relationships end very quickly, and they're constantly screwing everything that moves.
And you think it would be better for them if they had the marriage?
Gay people are only 3% of the population in the whole world, so then we think we did.
I've missed you again. Go ahead.
Do you think that maybe humans might need structure, even if you are self-regimented? Maybe that marriage and the contact and everything is super sensible, because coming from me, my boyfriend's a police officer, and people can't even do the things on their own with the law, much less without them. So I think without a speed limit sign or without different rules, people are going to break them either way. But I think without them, you would be just going crazy. There would be no structure. And I think that humans as a whole need structure. And maybe that's what marriage is. Maybe it's not a thing that hurts everyone, but I think and maybe it's not, I mean, just like you were saying, there's not a ring on your finger to know. And I don't think it's so much that, like, reminding you, like, the marriage certificate saying, oh, I love my husband or I love my wife. I think it's just the fact that it's structure, and everyone needs structure. People go crazy, just like the women at the end of the 1800s that were just stuck in their homes and either put them in these crazy rooms. I've read so much literature on these crazy women that just went nuts, and then they put them in a room and they went more crazy. They have no time structure and no structure in general.
And that's really why people, I think, enter into marriage is for the structure argument, especially when young people. When you're just out of school, you don't know what to do with your life, you want structure. Freedom doesn't mean a lot to young people as much as wanting structure. And that's why the military is very attractive to young people, because the military promises structure. I think as you get older, you realize that you don't need this external structure as much as you thought you needed it. And when you get to be my age, you begin to think, no, I don't need external structure. I can structure this, you know, with someone that works with me. I can structure on my own, and I don't need an external force to tell me how to structure my life.
I agree with you, but do you have a routine? Do you wake up in the morning and brush your teeth and then do this and do that? I think that marriage a lot of times is just like a routine, and it keeps you in balance. And I don't think it's the fact of forgetting that you're in marriage or somebody coming up to you and saying, ooh, are you married? I don't think it has to do with that. I think it's just, it keeps you in line. I think when you have a structure like that, it's hard to veer off.
And when I talk to people my age who have been married once or twice, that's what they say about their first marriage. I wanted structure at that time. I thought that's what everybody did. I thought that's the way things worked, and so that's what I did. But when you get to be my age, and maybe you still get married, you're doing it for different reasons. You don't need the structure. Your whole perspective has changed from an external one where, okay, what is the structure going to be imposed on me to doing what's really right for you. Yes?
You talk about freedom. Can this is something that comes up in virtually every class, every semester that I teach. And the question is, are we, as a culture, responsible enough to deal with all of the freedoms that we truly want? And my answer is no, we're not.
True.
And I think there is a optimal degree of freedom. Now, freedom is important. This country was based on freedom. We've gone to war to provide our society with a degree of freedom. But I think times have changed, and we've gotten to the point where that optimal point of freedom is moved all the way over in one direction, way over in that direction, where more freedom is only benefiting small special interest groups, but it's not for the greater good of society. We can't even solve the small problems anymore. Like, I may want to smoke, and I may want the freedom to smoke wherever and whenever I want, where the person sitting next to me wants the freedom to breathe clean air. How are you going to resolve that? But when you take this concept of freedom and you apply it to marriage, to me, this is what happens. If we're two individuals and we come together in this institution of marriage and we are focused on maintaining our individuality, having enough freedom to be whoever we want, the problem here is that it may work for you, but think about your partner having the same degree of freedom. And what that's going to rob from you is your ability to have a significant and profound effect on who your partner becomes. And your partner is not going to have a significant and profound effect on you and who you become. And therefore, the institution of marriage will become devalued when we base it on freedom. Of course, we are going to bring that level of freedom back to a more optimal point, which means that I am going to lose some of my individuality, and so is my partner. But that is not necessarily bad in the institution of marriage for the partners. It's not bad. When you look at it and say, well, what has my marriage cost me? It has cost me much of my individuality. Well, good. That is good, because now you're a part of that team. It's like what Raphael is saying here. I'm not going to go out there and try to be that superstar and make all of the touchdowns. I'm going to contribute to this team. My partner should influence me in a positive way to shape me in who I become, and I should have the same degree of influence on my partner. I should not be free to do whatever passes my mind at the moment to react on that. And if I do, and I do have that freedom, then what we're doing is perpetuating irresponsibility. Nobody wins in the end. Nobody will win. Then we're all free. Then there's no such thing as freedom. Freedom is an illusion.
I say you can still be free and be committed. And you can be as committed in a free state. In fact, you're having the freedom to choose from any man or woman in the universe just emphasizes how important this relationship is. And you keep coming back to the same person. It proves how your love really works. Now, I'm beginning to get a little fried here. So we've been at it for almost 2.25 hours, and I think I need a break. So we could go on for hours and hours more. So I think we should kind of wrap it up at this point. We can. You can always email me your questions. Now, I have a little flyer for you, for those of you who remain. This is my website. It leads to a lot of different stuff. You probably have to dig deep to find the marriage book, but it leads to a lot of different stuff. I've got my fingers in all sorts of pies. If you look up that website, you'll also find my Facebook page. Please friend me on Facebook. I need the friends. I really do. This is my manifesto. Now, before you think I'm making a stand on gay marriage itself, it says ban gay marriage, heterosexual marriage too. So, and this has one of my websites that could read.
Oh, this was to say that you can get faster to the website by Googling the name of the book.
That might be an idea.
Yeah.
But just aliens on Earth. We are all aliens.
No, I'm just saying, like, if you're having trouble, you go to your website and
you have trouble looking for the book, you can go to Google.
The name of the book. Okay, so I'll leave you with this flyer, and I hope to hear from some of you so we can debate. And this is my best friend right here. She totally believes it. Well, she's aggressive too. And I really enjoyed this. This is the first acknowledgement. No one has acknowledged my work.
See, we're special.
Right here, Daytona Beach.
Thank you very much.
All right, my recorder, 2 hours and 12 minutes.